Okay, so good morning all of you. Welcome to this fourth lecture of applied thermodynamics in advanced technical training. So in last few lectures, so we have studied about the basic laws of thermodynamics. Then in the last lecture, I have given the concept of availability, that is maximum useful work that can be obtained from a system. And today lecture, we'll move further. So we'll today study vapor power cycles, right? So the syllabus for the vapor power cycles, or in short, it is also called as power plant engineering. So first is properties of pure substances, then a Rankine cycle. So we'll compare what is Carnot cycle, Rankine cycle. Then we'll see boilers, turbines, and nozzles. So boilers, turbine, nozzles, very least part is there in the syllabus. So we'll just take a quick overview, but majority focus will be given on Rankine cycle and vapor power cycles in short. Okay, so it all starts with the thermopower plant. So you already have studied in your second year of engineering. The subject was applied thermodynamics. So thermodynamics and application was thermal power plant. So what you see on the screen is the schematic or image for a thermal power plant. So what you see there is the power plant is there. Then this whole building, this three storage or four story building, what you see here on four, this is a boiler. Then boiler supplies the steam to the turbine. And what you see here at the nine, these are the turbines. So there are multiple turbines are there, low pressure turbine, intermediate pressure turbine, and high pressure turbine. So after turbine, we get the work, turbine is connected to the generator. Generator gives us the electricity. After turbine, that steam goes to the condenser. Okay, so here is the condenser part, steam is condensed to water, and after that it is passed to the again to the boiler. Okay, again this condenser is cooled with the help of a cooling tower. So here we have this cooling towers are there. Cooling towers supply the cooling water to the condenser, and that cycle again repeats. Okay, so in our theory, we might have seen this boiler, we say, as a like symbol like this, but in actual, it can go up to three storage or four storage building, right? This is a schematic or the image, concept image for a thermal power plant, right? Okay, this is another image is there, schematic. So again, it is shown in this case. So it all starts with the boiler, okay? So boiler takes the water, it converts it into steam, it is supplied to the turbine, right? In turbine, work takes place. The shaft of the turbine is coupled with the generator, and generator gives us the electricity, right? Then that steam, after turbine, it is passed to the condenser. In condenser, we get the cooling water from the cooling tower, okay? Again, that steam is condensed to water, the water is pumped back to the boiler with the help of a boiler feed pump. Okay, this is the simple cycle of the vapor power plant. Okay, now first we'll see what is a steam vapor. Okay, steam is the most common working fluid used in vapor power cycles because of its many desirable characteristics, such as low cost, availability, and high enthalpy of vaporization. That high enthalpy of vaporization is nothing but the latent heat of vaporization. So that is high for the water. Again, it is available everywhere. And as it is available everywhere, it is having low cost. Now, steam power plants are commonly referred to as coal plants because we use coal for the burning of fuel. Then second is nuclear power plants. Third is natural gas plants, depending on the type of the fuel used for the supply heat to the steam. The steam goes through the same basic cycle in all of them. Therefore, all can be analyzed in the same manner. Okay. So, like majority of the power plants in India, they operate on coal. Now, coal is a non-renewable source of energy. We cannot generate coal for thousands of years. There is some limitation on it. Then there are some non-renewable sources of energy like solar, wind, but they have very low capacity. So coal has its advantages, disadvantages. So nuclear power plants are now being very famous, though that fear is there for the nuclear fission. But If you see the history or the records, nuclear power plants actually are very efficient and they are producing very less emissions compared to coal power plants. Okay. Now there was very big, huge publicity was there for solar power plants, wind power plants. But when they actually seen the scenario, so if you want to install a solar power plant, so you have to cut thousands of trees over a large acre, and then you have to install the solar power plants. So that was the thing. So then again, if you compare the performance and electricity generation, that performance was very low for the solar power plants. But again, these European countries, first they shifted towards solar and wind, then again they are shifting back to the nuclear power plants. Though there is a risk for nuclear reactions, but still they provide very clean source of energy. Okay. Now, before going to the actual Rankine cycle, we'll go through first Carnot vapor cycle. Carnot cycles are very famous. They are comprising of all reversible cycles, and hence they are said to be having more efficiency. The Carnot cycle is the most efficient power cycle operating between two specified temperature limits. So there is this diagram, very famous, you might already know, TS diagram for Carnot cycle. So we have these temperature limits here. This is a higher temperature limit, that is TH. This is a low temperature limit, that is TL. Heat is added at the higher temperature, QH. It is released at lower temperature, that is QL. And some amount of work is being produced. Okay. And some amount of work is also required for compression. So that has to be supplied. So that will be pump work or compressor work. Okay. So this is a simple Carnot cycle. Carnot cycle is the most efficient power cycle operating between two specified temperature limits. We can adopt the Carnot cycle first as a prospective ideal cycle for vapor power plants. Okay, so that is ideal cycle. Sequence of processes, reversible and isothermal heating in a boiler, so that is heat is added. Isentropy expansion in turbine, that is work is produced. Reversible and isothermal condensation, that is heat is being lost to the condenser, from condenser to the atmosphere. Isentropic compression, that is pump work, or we can say compressor work, whatever. Like if it is a gas, that will be compressor. If it is a liquid, that will be pump. Now the main question here arises, is Carnot cycle practical? So Carnot cycle is not suitable model for actual power cycle because of several impracticalities associated with. A process 1 to 2, that is heat addition process, limiting the heat transfer process to two-phase system severely limits the maximum temperature that can be used for a cycle. Now, like if you want to add heat, in that case, if you are using the water, this two-phase system, steam and water, that has some limitations of temperatures. So you can not go above that temperature, right? Now process 2 to 3, again that process is isothermal. Isothermal processes are also practically impossible, and because those are very slow processes. Isothermal processes are very slow processes. Isentropic processes, on the other hand, are very fast processes. Now process 2 to 3, turbine cannot handle steam with high moisture content because of the impingement of liquid droplets on the turbine blades, causing erosion and wear. So if it is having any so here in this case, if you see, so this is a locus for the saturation. At point one, it is a liquid saturated. At point two, it is dry saturated. If I go through turbines, this is a turbine phase. There are chances of wet steam. Now wet steam can erode the blades of the turbine, so it is very dangerous. Now process 4 to 1, again, it is not practical to design a compressor that handle two phases. So compressor cannot handle two phases. A pump can handle only liquid, or compressor can handle only gases. So both cannot handle two phases at a time. Now, what is the solution for this if Carnot cycle is not practical? Is Rankine cycle. Okay. So many impracticalities associated with the Carnot cycle can be eliminated by superheating the steam in the boiler, okay, and condensing the steam completely in the condenser. So whatever limitations for previously were there, that turbine cannot handle wet steam, we cannot eliminate that by superheating the steam. And second thing, like we can condense the steam completely in the condenser. The modified Carnot cycle is called as Rankine cycle, which is ideal and practical cycle for vapor power plants. This ideal cycle does not involve any internal irreversibilities. Irreversibility accounts for the loss of the work that we have seen in last lecture. Okay. So this is a Carnot cycle here, and a modified Carnot cycle or the actual. So the cycle we can actually apply in power cycles is Rankine cycle. Okay. So I'll explain one by one. What is the here 1-2 process? 1-2 process is pumping the water to boiler pressure. Pump water to boiler pressure, that is PV. Again, 1-2, what is 1-2? Here it is heat addition process. So heat addition in, sorry, not 1-2, that will be 2-3. Heat addition in boiler. So heat is added and it is superheated. Okay. So this is a saturation curve. Whatever left side of saturation curve, that will be liquid. Whatever right side, that will be superheated, or we can say gas. And at this apex point, here it is called as critical point. Okay. Now, how to achieve this saturation curve? That will also I will explain. Okay. So it all starts with the phase change process, right? So if I draw a graph of, let us say, temperature versus enthalpy, okay? So phase change process for, let us say, liquid to gas, okay? So what is, suppose it is at this temperature, suppose initial temperature is 27 degrees Celsius, it is having some enthalpy here. Now, when I increase the temperature, the heat is being added, it increases up to a point, this point. Now this point is called as saturation temperature. This is called as saturation temperature. Now what happens at saturation temperature? The condition here, it is liquid saturated. Liquid saturated. What happens after that? Latent heat is added to change the phase of liquid to vapor. So it is added at a constant temperature. Temperature remains constant when we are adding the latent heat. So here liquid saturated means that dryness fraction, that will be zero. That means there is no presence of gas. Now latent heat is added, latent heat of vaporization is added here, right? Then it is coming to this point. Now this point is called as dry saturated. This is called as dry saturated, means that X value, dryness fraction, will be equal to 1. Again, from this point onwards, what will happen? Only gas will be present, or the steam will be present. Now, if I increase the temperature, the graph will look like this. Okay. So here, this phase, we are term it as a superheated state after dry saturation. Before liquid saturation, this is subcooled. Okay. Now this is applicable, let us say, for pressure 1 bar. Now if I draw for 2 bar condition, in that case this graph might look like this. Okay, so this is for pressure equal to 2 bar. If I draw for, let us say, 10 bar, this will look suppose like this. So as we increase the pressure, this latent heat required decreases. So let us say this is for 10 bar. Now all these are the saturation points here, right? Now if I join these saturation points, it will look like this. Okay. If I extend this curve, this will be like this. Okay, so this will be like this. Okay, so this is how we achieve the locus. And here again, this apex point, here we are referring it as a critical point. Now what happens at critical point? If I am having a pressure equal to critical, so in that case, this liquid come to critical point and directly it will be converted into steam. So there will be no play of latent heat. Okay. Again, if I have a pressure above critical, so that will be called as supercritical. So in that case, again, the graph will look like this. Okay. So no latent heat will be required in that case. Right. So this is how we'll achieve the locus for the saturation curve. Okay, again, in Rankine cycle, so this is how we achieved this locus. Inside the locus, we have seen Carnot cycle, practical is the Rankine cycle. What are the sequences here? The ideal Rankine cycle consists of four processes. 1 to 2, isentropic compression in water pump here. Then constant pressure heat addition in boiler here. Isentropic expansion in turbine where work is produced. And constant pressure heat rejection in condenser. And this is its TS diagram. Okay. So I hope I'm refreshing your memory about these vapor power cycles. Now let us do the energy analysis, and by that energy analysis we can achieve the efficiency, or we can calculate the efficiency. The pump, boiler, turbine, condenser are steady flow devices. Thus all four processes that make up the ideal Rankine cycle can be analyzed as steady flow processes. This is a very important statement. All the processes are analyzed as steady flow processes. The kinetic and potential energy changes of the system are usually small. Thus the steady flow energy equation per unit mass of the system reduces to. So here we are neglecting the potential energy and kinetic energy of the fluid or of the steam. So this is the equation here, Qin minus Qout. Qin is from boiler, Qout is from condenser. Okay, We is from the pump, Wout is from the turbine. This is how we achieve HE minus HI, initial exit enthalpy minus initial enthalpy. Okay. So energy interactions here in this case, the boiler, the condenser does not involve any work, but both involve with the heat interaction. So boiler and condenser, these are associated with only heat interactions. Pump and the turbine are assumed to be isentropic and both involve work interactions. So these are associated with only work. So turbine work, we are considering it as positive. Pump work, that will be negative. Heat added will be positive. Heat lost, that will be negative. So pump work here, that is will be given by enthalpy at the exit H2 minus H1. Again, boiler will be given as H3 minus H2. Turbine will be given as H3 minus H4. Because in this case, we are utilizing this energy of steam to convert into work. So H3 minus H4. And condenser will be H4 minus H1. Okay. So if I want to calculate the efficiency in this case, what will be the efficiency? Total work output divided by total heat input. So in this case, that will be turbine work minus pump work, divided by heat added in boiler. So that will be its thermal efficiency. Okay. So thermal efficiency will be, of Rankine cycle is determined from thermal efficiency equal to W net upon Qin, or we can say 1 minus Qout divided by Qin, where net work output is turbine workout minus pump work in. So the thermal efficiency of Rankine cycle can only be interpreted as the ratio of area enclosed by the cycle on TS diagram to the area under heat addition process. So total net, so W net is nothing but the area under this curve. Area under this curve, that will be your W net. Okay. Now that was all about ideal Rankine cycle. Now we'll see what are the actual vapor power cycle, that is actual Rankine cycle. What are the irreversibilities present in actual Rankine cycle? Okay. So actual power cycle differ from the ideal Rankine cycle as a result of irreversibilities in various components. Two common sources of irreversibilities are fluid friction and heat loss to the surrounding. Now fluid flows through the pipes. So in that case, there will be friction between fluid and the surface. The next is heat loss to the surrounding. So though we say these processes are adiabatic, there will be some heat loss to the surrounding. Okay. So fluid friction causes pressure drops in the boiler, condenser, and the piping between various components. Water must be pumped to higher pressure, requires a larger pump and large work input. So in order to compensate that frictional loss, we need to have a larger pump work. More heat needs to be transferred to the system in the boiler to compensate for the undesirable heat losses from the system to the surrounding. As a result, cycle thermal efficiency decreases. Now here there is a figure there is a actual, sorry, there is an ideal vapor power cycle or Rankine cycle, and then there is an actual Rankine cycle. Now, what is happening in this case? This entropy value changes. Okay, so initially this was the 0.3, this was the point, so let us say 3 dash, this is a 4 dash. Okay, so it is assumed that the entropy during expansion in turbine remains same, but in actual what happens? This entropy increases. So irreversibility increases, that means entropy increases, or irreverse also we can say, entropy increases, that means irreversibility increases. Again, in pump, entropy is said to be having constant, but in actual what happens? Entropy increases, that means irreversibility or loss of work in the turbine increases, sorry, in the pump increases. Again, this boiler heat addition is said to be constant temperature, but temperature decreases due to heat transfer. Again, in condenser, this heat transfer is said to be at constant temperature, but in this case what happens? Temperature decreases from inlet to outlet because of heat transfer. Okay, so depending on that deviations in entropies, we have isentropic efficiencies. A pump requires a greater work input and turbine produces a smaller work output as a result of irreversibility. Okay, so deviation in actual pump and turbines from the isentropic ones can also be accounted by utilizing isentropic efficiencies, which are defined as, if I take isentropic efficiency for the pump, so in that case that will be WS minus WA. So WA is nothing but the actual pump work required, and this is a theoretical one. So theoretical pump work divided by actual pump work. So that will be its isentropic efficiency for the pump. For turbine, same. We are going for the theoretical. So theoretical will be at the bottom for turbine, and actual will be at the top. Whatever will be larger, that will be always in the denominator. Whatever will be lesser, that will be in the numerator. Okay. In actual condenser, the liquid is usually subcooled to prevent the onset of cavitation, which may damage the water pump. Additional losses occur at the bearings between the moving parts as a result of friction. This is another source of friction between bearings. Two other factors are the steam that leaks out during the cycle and air that leaks into the condenser. So these are the some sources of losses or irreversibilities in the power cycle. Now, there are some methods to increase the efficiency of Rankine cycle. So you already have studied. So I will just take a quick review of that. So first one is the lowering condenser pressure. So see here, our main objective is to increase this area. We have to increase this net work output. Okay. How to increase that area? In this case, first case, we have lowered the condenser pressure. By lowering the condenser pressure, we are achieving this much amount of extra work. Okay. Right. But there is a side effect. If I lower this condenser pressure, what will happen? Some wet steam will be produced here, and wet steam can erode the blades of the turbine. Okay. Second is superheating the steam to higher temperature. This is very desirable. So again, as I told you, our main objective is to increase the area under this closed cycle. So I can increase that with the help of superheating the steam. Superheating has another advantages that it is very desirable for the turbine, because turbine can handle only dry steam, right? So definitely in this case, thermal efficiency increases. Next is increasing boiler pressure. Okay. Now again, the previous one is here. This was the previous work, net work output from the system, right? If I increase the boiler pressure, in that case, this will be increased work output. But if you see in this case, what happens? For a fixed turbine inlet temperature, cycle shifts to the left and the moisture content of the steam at the turbine exit increases. So as the moisture content increases, that blades can erode. Right. So what will be the, so these are some methods. First, you can either reduce the condenser pressure and you can increase the boiler pressure, or you can superheat the steam. Okay. There is again another method or another way is there, which is called subcooling. but it is generally not discussed in this case. Subcooling is majorly discussed in the subject of refrigeration and air conditioning. Okay, so these are some methods: lowering condenser pressure, increasing temperature or superheating the steam, or increasing the boiler pressure. Okay, now there are two other methods are also there. So actually there are various methods are there. You can reheat the steam, you can regenerate the water, and there is another like a combined vapor power cycle is there. There is a cogeneration vapor power cycle is there. So various methods are there to increase the thermal efficiency of vapor power plant. Okay, so we cannot discuss all these details in this limited time, so I'm just giving the overview. So next will be reheating the cycle. So ideal reheat Rankine cycle. Okay, so this you can dictate from the diagram also. So from boiler, steam goes to the first turbine, that is a high pressure turbine. In that case, whatever steam is coming out, so that is again passed to the boiler. So that word comes from that process, reheating. So we are again reheating the steam, the Drainer fraction increases, again we are passing it to the low pressure turbine, and then we get the steam to the condenser, and then the cycle repeats. So that's why the name comes reheat cycle. Okay, so reheating is a practical solution to the excessive moisture problems in turbines, and it is commonly used in modern steam power plants. This is done by expanding the steam in two-stage turbine and reheat the steam in between the stages. So this was not there in your ATD syllabus, reheat cycle, regenerative cycles. So that we'll discuss today. So if you see the TS diagram here, up to this point it is same, up to boiler, up to point 3. But after 3, it expands in high pressure boiler, okay, up to point 4. Again it is reheated in boiler to point 5, and then it is expanded in the low pressure turbine. Okay, so this is how that reheat cycle looks like. So here is the energy equations for that. In this case, that turbine output or the network output increases because we have two turbines now, turbine 1 and turbine 2. Heating input also increases, that is primary and then reheat. Okay. Now next here it is ideal regenerative Rankine cycle. So regenerative cycle, there are two types: open feed water heater system and closed feed water heater system. Okay. So what is that? Again, we'll see. So again, up to this point, from boiler to turbine, the process is same, but some part of steam is taken out, okay, in the open feed water heater, okay, and then some part of steam is passed to the condenser. It is converted into water. Again, it is passed to the open feed water heater. So here we have steam, and here we have water. So these are openly mixed. So that is the word comes from open, openly mixed here. Again, passed to the boiler, okay. So this is an open feed water heater system, and it is comes under regenerative Rankine cycle. Then there is next closed feed water heater system. Again, in this case, up to this point, cycle is same. After that, some part of steam is taken out. So suppose here it is 1. So X amount of is taken out, and 1 minus X amount of is sent to the condenser. Again, they both come together here. But here in this case, these are not mixed openly. So this water passes through tubes, and steam is spread over these tubes. Heat transport takes place. Then they are passed to the mixing chamber, and then it is sent to the boiler. So here in this case, total temperature in the system is maintained very high. Okay. So as the temperature of heat addition increases, efficiency of power plant increases. So you can read about this in details also. I have given in this PPT. You can read it. Right. Then other methods, as I mentioned, so there are other methods also, which is a cogeneration method is there. Okay. In cogeneration, whatever heat is lost to the condenser, that heat is utilized for other processes. Then we have combined vapor power cycle. So such like other methods are there. Okay, so that's it for today's lecture. That's theory for today's lecture. We'll solve some problems now. Quickly, I will take the overview of whatever we have learned up to this point. Okay, so we have studied, seen the thermopower plant, right? Schematic. Then we have seen the Carnot cycle. I explained you about the how to draw the locus for this vapor power cycles. So the Rankine cycle we have seen. Then energy analysis, how to calculate thermal efficiency. Okay, an actual vapor power cycle we have seen the irreversibilities in the actual cycle. Then we have seen the isentropic efficiency, right? Then we have seen the methods of increasing the efficiency, that is lowering condenser pressure, increasing boiler pressure, superheating the steam. Then we have seen the two methods of increasing the efficiency, reheat and regeneration. Okay. Again, in regeneration, there are two types, open and closed feed water heater system. Okay, so I hope you understood some part of it. Right, so we'll solve some problems so your concepts will be more clear. The first one is here, in a Rankine cycle, heat is added. So you have four options, reversibly at constant volume, reversibly at constant temperature, reversibly at constant pressure and temperature, reversibly at constant pressure. So what is the correct answer? So what will be the answer here? In a Rankine cycle, heat is added. Okay, so we have one answer. Others also, please participate. Okay. Unless and until you practice or you participate, you won't understand a thing. That is the difference between listening and understanding. You can listen whatever you want, but when it comes to understanding, you have to do it on your own. Okay, others? Should I call their names? Yasser, Khatik, Komal. Again, who is there? Aditya Motewar, Survey, Vinayak Bapat. Okay. What is the correct answer here? D is one given by Shraddha. So, what will the correct answer for this? If you see the Rankine cycle, I will draw here. Let's say T versus S. This is the locus for the saturation. So let us say start with pump work. So this is the pump work, 0.2. Then this is up to 0.3 boiler. 3 to 4 is condenser. And here 4 to 1 is. 4 to 1 is condenser, 3 to 4 is turbine, boiler and pump. So you can see that the heat is added at constant pressure. So this is the line for the constant pressure. So D is the correct answer. Right? Next is a steam power plant has a boiler efficiency of 92%, turbine efficiency of 94%, generator efficiency is 95%, cycle efficiency is 44%. If 6% of the generated power is used to run the auxiliaries, the overall plant efficiency. So this is a very interesting problem. We know the individual efficiencies of the components, and then you have to calculate the overall efficiency. Okay. So please calculate.
So how to calculate this? In this case, you have to take the multiplication of all the efficiencies. When you take multiplication of all the efficiencies, you will get the overall efficiency. Now tell the answer. So calculate efficiency. Well, I will take simply the multiplication of all the efficiencies here. So first is 92, so that will be 0.92. So into 0.94 into 0.95 into 0.44 again into 0.06. That will be 0.92 into 0.94 this into 0.95 this into 0.44, right? And 6% of it utilized to auxiliary, so like they have to, we have to subtract it from 100, so that will be 94%. So this into 0.94, so that should be 33.97. So we have here 34. So A will be the correct answer here. Okay, so overall efficiency will be equal to multiplication of all the efficiencies. That will be 0.92 into 0.94 into 0.95. to 0.44, and here 6% of the generated power utilized to auxiliary, so that you have to subtract from 100. So efficiency here it is 94%. So that gives you, suppose 34, or you can say 34%. Okay. Now next, the gas turbine hot combustion products with the specific heat Cp and Cv is given, enters the turbine at 20 bar and 1500 Kelvin and exits at 1 bar. The isentropy efficiency of the turbine is 94%. The work developed by the turbine per kg of gas flow is. So this is related to the isentropic efficiency. So isentropic efficiency for the turbine that we already know, it is a ratio of actual work divided by theoretical work. So that will be equal to actual work divided by theoretical work. To calculate both these works, so what will be the area that is present in the cycle? Okay, any luck? So here we have to calculate the turbine work. It will be equal to enthalpy at the outlet. Enthalpy, we can write it as a Cp delta T. So let us say outlet temperature, inlet temperature will be higher minus outlet temperature. So that we have to determine. Now in this case, let us see what values we have here. So here we have T1 as 1500 Kelvin, which is given already. In this case, P1 is given 20 bar. P2 is given 1 bar. Okay. What else is given in this case? Cp and Cv are given. So Cp is given 0.98. Cv is given 0.75. Okay. Isentropic efficiency of the turbine is given. So that is given here in this case 0.94. Okay. We have to determine the turbine work. Okay. Now see here, the unknown part here it is T2. T2 is unknown. Without T2, we cannot calculate the work. How to calculate T2? So we have to take the advantages of isentropic processes. Okay. So there is a formula for isentropic processes. T1 divided by T2, that will be equal to T1 divided by P2. Raised to gamma minus 1 upon gamma. Gamma is nothing but the ratio of specific heat, Cp divided by Cv. Okay, so this will be equal to 0.98 divided by 0.75. So calculate this gamma and put that value there. So T1 is given 1500 divided by T2 is unknown. So this will be equal to P1 is given 20 bar divided by 1. Raised to calculate this gamma value, what it comes. This gamma value P980.98 divided by what is the next? 0.75, right? 0.7538. It comes out to be 1.3. Okay. So here it will be 1.3 minus 1 divided by 1.3. So you can calculate easily T2. Okay. Calculate a T2. What is the T2 here? The T2, so that's calculated as 751.36. So don't worry about this formula. Okay, this formula is very standard. You can mug it. So if you take isentropic process, there are formulas for P and V also. There are formulas for the T and temperature also, temperature and pressure also. So these are the standard formulas. Okay. Now what is happening in this case? If you see Rankine cycle, with the help of Rankine cycle, I can explain this. So temperature versus entropy is there, and I'm drawing that Rankine cycle for this case. So this is your ideal Rankine cycle, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4. Okay, but actually what happens, this process 3 to 4 is not isentropic, so that entropy actually increases in this case. This is a 4 dash. Okay, in our case that will be 2 dash. We have calculated the T2 value here, and then we can calculate the work done in this case. Okay. So here work done, that formula is given, or the efficiency, isentropic efficiency formula is given. So isen is equal to, so WA actual work is nothing but Cp into T1 minus T2. Okay. Actual work Theoretical will be Cp divided by T1 minus T2 S kiwa T2 dash. Okay. So this is the theoretical one. So let's say this is T2 and this is T2 dash. So here we have calculated the T2. T2 dash is still unknown. So T2 dash is required in order to calculate this turbine work. So I'll write that formula. Cp, Cp will cancel. So T1 minus T2 dash divided by T1 minus T2. So I'll write the values here. 1500 minus T2 dash is unknown. That is actual temperature drop. 1500 minus here 751.36. And this value is known here, that is 0.94. Okay. From this, you can calculate the T2 dash. Okay. So T2 dash is the actual temperature after expansion that we have to know in order to calculate actual work done by the turbine. So calculate the T2 dash. So yes, has given the answer. Good. 796.3. 796.3. Okay. So see, from this expression, you can say that actually, theoretically, that temperature should be 751, but due to irreversibility in the turbine, the temperature increases to 796.3. Okay. So this can happen if there are some irreversibilities in the system. Now you can easily calculate the turbine work. That will be equal to Cp into T1 minus T2 dash. So Cp is given here as 0.98 into 1500 minus 796.3. So you can easily calculate the work done in the turbine. So yes, calculate the turbine work. So in your second year, you actually made the use of steam tables, but in your gate exam or baki je kahi competitive exam asel tya case madhe kay asnar tumhala steam table lagnar nahi. In that case, they directly give the enthalpy values. They are not given the enthalpy values, you can directly calculate enthalpy from the formula Cp delta T or Cpt. What is the work done here in this case? Okay, so that's your answer, 698.62. Okay, so where is the answer here? 698. Okay, so there is no option here, 698. There is a 689 is there. Okay, 689 is correct answer. So option A will be correct. So this was asked for 2 marks in GATE 2003. Right? I hope you understood the problem here. This is related to isentropic efficiency. Isentropic efficiency means actual work done divided by theoretical work done for turbine. In case of pump, that will be inverse. So in case of pump, that will be actual work required divided by, sorry, theoretical work required divided by actual work required. Whatever will be the less, that will be numerator. Okay. Next MCQ. In Rankine cycle, regeneration results in higher efficiency because pressure inside the boiler increases or the heat added before the steam enters the low pressure turbine. Average temperature of heat addition in boiler increases. Total work delivered by the turbine increases. What was the correct answer here? Give your thoughts. Okay, Akash is saying average temperature of heat addition in the boiler increases. So that is the correct answer. So see, one by one, pressure inside boiler increases. So pressure has nothing to do with the regeneration. In the regeneration, what we are doing, we are taking some part of turbine, X part, we are taking out. Then we are mixing it with the water coming from the condenser. Okay, so there is water, there is a steam, and then we are mixing it together. Right? Then again, it is applied to the boiler. In this case, heat is added before steam enters the lotus pressure turbine. So this is related to reheat, not the regeneration. Average temperature of heat addition in the boiler increases. So that is true. So why we are mixing steam with water? To increase the temperature inside the boiler. Total work delivered by the turbine increases. So this may be correct, may not be correct. If they are asking for one mark, this is the only, like, one answer is correct. Most probable answer will be this one. C. Okay, so we have what, two more questions are there. One is theoretical one, another is calculation type. So we'll complete. The values of enthalpy of steam at the inlet and outlet of steam turbine of Rankine cycle are 2800 and 1800 kilojoule per kg respectively. The inleting pump work, the specific steam consumption in kilogram per kilowatt hour is. Actually, that is kilogram per kilowatt hour is correct. So this is a, again, new term, specific steam consumption. In that case, you have to just divide 3600 divided by the your work. So that will be kg per kilowatt hour. This should be provided, it should be in kilojoule per kg. Okay. So here straight away turbine work is, we can calculate 2800 minus 1800, that will be 1000 kilojoule per kg. Pump work here it is zero, so net work will be equal to turbine work minus pump work, so that will be equal to 1000 kilojoule per kg. And then you can calculate specific steam consumption, 3600 divided by 1000, so this will be equal to 3.6 kilogram of steam per kilowatt hour energy. Okay, so 3.6 is correct answer. Sachin has given right answer. Also Rohit. Okay. This was asked for 2 marks for 2011 GATE. Last one here. Which one of the following modifications of the simple Rankine cycle increases the thermal increases the steam at the turbine outlet? So wait, let me just check what is the statement there. The correct statement is increases the thermal efficiency and reduces the moisture. Okay, so this should be this, and here it should be reducing. Increases the thermal efficiency and reduces moisture in the steam of the turbine outlet. So decreasing the boiler pressure, no, this should not be the correct answer, because this will again reduce the efficiency. And decreasing the condenser pressure, no, this is again opposite. Actually, this increases the work output. But here that efficiency decreases and moisture content increases, right? So if you want to show with TS diagram. Right. Let's say this is the initial cycle. If I decrease the condenser pressure like this, decreasing the condenser pressure. So no doubt in this case work output of the network increases, but here in this case moisture content also increases. So initially this was the moisture content here, and again it is increasing. Okay. So moisture lines are there in the actual pH diagram. So like this constant moisture lines are there. This may be x equal to 0.6, this may be x equal to 0.8. Constant moisture lines are there. Again, increasing the boiler pressure. So yes, this is again correct, increasing the boiler pressure. This has to be there in consideration. Increasing the boiler pressure increases the efficiency, but in case it also increases the pump work. Pump work is also increased in case of increasing the boiler pressure. Increasing the turbine inlet temperature. So that means we are superheating the steam. So if I want to superheat the steam, this is the like, I can surely say that if I superheat the steam, in that case, the work output will increase as well as the moisture content in this steam at the turbine outlet also will decrease. Okay. So superheating plays important role. If I superheat up to this extent, then there will be no moisture in steam. If I superheat up to this extent, lower extent, there will be some chances of steam. So more I superheat, less chances of moisture will be there. So this is the right answer. This was asked in 2019. So last to last year for 1 mark in GATE examination. Okay. Again, one numerical, it is there, but I will leave it for your practice. Okay. So this is the last one. Which one of the following statements regarding a Rankine cycle with reheating are true? Increasing average temperature of heat addition, reduction in thermal energy efficiency, drier steam at turbine exit. So these are the three statements. Then there are four options. Only one and two is correct. Only two and three is correct. Only one and three are correct. All are correct. Okay, so what is the correct option here? Rohit is saying B. Akash C. Again, anybody else? Bagul is typing C. Okay, Sandeep Bagul. Sajin is saying C. Okay, so see, we'll see one by one. The best strategy here in this case is to eliminating what is wrong. Instead of selecting what is correct, first go for eliminating. Je kai tumhala barobar vatat nasel pahile eliminate kara. Je rahile te rahile. First is increasing average temperature of addition. So this is the main objective of reheat cycle. Reduction in thermal efficiency. So this is not true. Efficiency is increases. That is why we are adopting reheat and regeneration. Then there is a dry steam at the steam turbine. So as we increase the temperature, obviously it goes into superheated stage. Then we get a dry steam. So 1 and 3 are correct, so that will be C. Okay. This was asked for again 1 mark in 2015 GATE exam. Right. So I think that is enough for today. There is one more example is there, which is numerical one. So you can solve it on your own. Right. Okay. Again, at the end of the lecture, I will give you that made easy question bank is there. So I will give you that scan PDF. Okay. So quickly I will take. total 53. That means 51 students are there. Right. Okay, so thank you for attending. So that is for today's lecture. In next lecture, I will start reciprocating air compressors and other parts like boiler and turbine. So we'll take small review of those chapters. Okay. So by the end of like next two lectures, your syllabus for ATD will be over. So thank you for attending. See you in next lecture.